Chapter 1 of Christian Home Life. Christian Home Life by S.S. Pugh. Introductory. The heart has many a dwelling spot on lifetime's pilgrim way, in many lands where human lot leads human foot to stray. But time nor change can e'er efface this truth where'er we roam, that the heart has many a dwelling place, but only once a home. The cot may for a palace change by fortune's golden spell, but this can ne'er our love estrange from what the past can tell. That truth which memory loves to trace still lives beneath the dome, that the heart has many a dwelling place, but only once a home. Frederick Enoch. When the Most High was about to bestow upon Abraham a new and signal mark of the divine favour, the reason assigned for it was, "For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment." When a judgment was about to descend upon the house of Eli, so terrible that both the ears of everyone that heareth it shall tingle, it was because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not. The prophet Jeremiah invokes the wrath of God upon the families that call not on thy name, and he is commissioned to declare in the name of the Lord, "I will be the God of all the families of Israel." In such words as these, and scripture is full of them, parents and heads of families have both solemn warning and gracious encouragement. Blessings are promised and judgments are denounced according to the violation or observance of parental duties and family relationships. Even apart from the clear and explicit statements of Scripture, reason suffices to show the immense influence exerted by our home life upon our interests, for both time and for eternity. Heathen moralists, no less than Christian teachers, have strenuously insisted upon the importance of family piety as essential to public virtue. But whilst all admit this, too many rest satisfied with a mere verbal acknowledgement of it. Their words neither express any deep conviction nor produce any practical result. Though called, as the heads of households, to a post of great responsibility, they do not really recognize their position, and they sadly fail in the discharge of their duties, to their own sorrow and to the injury, often the irreparable injury, of those who are dependent upon them. Many who are conscious of their failure in this respect feel it painfully. They grieve over a disorderly household and disobedient children. They mourn over the evil ways of those whom they most dearly love. But they seem quite unable to remedy or even to arrest the evil. The fact is, they have never set themselves seriously and prayerfully to consider how they should fulfill their duties. They have contented themselves with wishing and sorrowing where they should have been prayerfully seeking strength to enable them to act. Some again fail in this duty for the want of vigilant, persevering effort to maintain their authority. They allow themselves to become careless. They pass by faults which ought to be noticed and checked. They let the reins of authority slip from their hands. Like Eli, they first allow their children to do what is right in their own eyes, and then are wanting in the moral courage necessary to recover their lost rule. An easy, good-natured, self-indulgent, or timid disposition on the part of parents will often thus bring ruin upon their children and misery upon their household. There are others who, earnestly desirous of fulfilling their duty, are in danger of failing through inexperience and ignorance. They do strive to be faithful, they sincerely aim to bring up their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and to command their household after them to keep his way. But they meet with many difficulties. Then they become disheartened and are tempted to give up trying. Or perhaps, having set themselves a high standard of household life, they are in danger of being too strict, of ruling by terror rather than by love. To such persons it is hoped that this book will prove suggestive and helpful. Its design is to deepen the convictions of Christian parents and heads of households as to their responsibilities, to point out the great objects of the family ordinance, to guide the inexperienced and to encourage by argument and example those to whom God has committed so solemn a trust. It is almost impossible to overestimate the importance of this subject. All true civilization, that is all civilization which has a large moral element, rests upon the basis of family life. Our greatest poet, speaking of marriage, says, "By thee, founded in reason, loyal, just, and pure, relations dear, and all the charities of father, son, and brother first were known. The common relationship secures mutual help and protection. Life and property are held sacred. A check is kept upon selfish cupidity. Chastity is honoured. Each is interested in the prosperity of all. The sorrow or misfortune of one is felt as a common calamity. A well-conducted family is a school of every social virtue. Reverence for a supreme authority, the existence of mutual rights, and the necessity of mutual service and subordination, the happiness resulting from an unselfish regard to each other's interests, are lessons which, learnt at home, best prepare us for the wider associations of life. The law of God and the welfare of the state most obviously coincide here. The family government underlies all forms of government, and woe to the state where the children are not governed under this older law. The mournful facts connected with our criminal population show us what crime and vice arise from its violation. Our criminal population is being constantly recruited from those who, almost from their birth, are destitute of parental control. Quote, "The system," says Dr. McCosh, "is an admirable adaptation to our state and nature. Wild theorists have laboured to overturn it, but God, in his providence, hath inscribed folly on all their mad and profane attempts to disturb his arrangements. And it has been found that after producing not a little temporary misery, these parties have been obliged to abandon their schemes as prejudicial or impracticable. In ancient Sparta, Lycurgus substituted public education for family training, and the experiment terminated in rendering a whole nation cold-hearted and selfish. Socialism, under some of its forms, has proposed to exchange a promiscuous for a household life, but, as might have been anticipated, the change, when carried into effect, has led to caprice and cruelty, and opened the floodgates to every form of vice." End quote. It is the exception when the well-educated and morally trained degrade their social position by flagrant acts of crime. There is, it is true, but one security for high-toned morality, the renewal of the nature by the Holy Spirit of God. But the instances in which wise home training fails to secure at least ordinary morality are exceptional, and in those cases we do not know how much the failure may be due to defective methods, or in how many cases the evil result may be traced to early evil tendencies undetected, to early evil habits unchecked. It may be fostered by home influence and example. The blessings of a pure home life we owe to the gospel. Heathenism has never produced it. Somewhere or other, there has always been a fatal flaw which has marred its beauty and destroyed its value. Neither Greece nor Rome knew it, in our sense of the words. We do not say that they never furnished bright examples of parental and filial affection, but all history attests that the family life, resting upon the mutual affection of husband and wife, who were united by an indissoluble tie which pledged them to purity, was unknown. Footnote: an exception should perhaps be made here as to the earliest and best days of the Roman Republic, but this is an exception which proves the rule. End footnote. What both these nations became through their violation of the law of the family, we do know. Their impurity sapped the foundation of every social compact, induced a life of mere selfish indulgence, and so prepared them for destruction. Their literary and artistic culture was no substitute for the homely virtues which grow up under the shelter of the family as divinely instituted. Those who so shamefully and systematically set at naught these most sacred ties came to be, and we cannot wonder at it, quote, "without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful," end quote. Footnote: Romans 1:31, end footnote. The pages of their own poets and historians bear witness that the apostle's estimate of the fearful depths of iniquity into which in his time they were sunk was neither partial nor prejudiced. The same fact meets us everywhere in heathen lands at the present day. Suttyism, infanticide, neglect of or positive cruelty to aged parents, and abominations of which it were a shame to speak, which have had their counterparts in heathenism in all ages, at once suggest themselves to our thoughts as no less opposed to the family institution than to the positive commands of God. What the state of society and of social morals is in India and under the influence of Mohammedanism, both there and in other lands, is too well known to need further mention. Home in our sense of the word, the sense which the word of God teaches us to give it, home as the abode of purity where children and parents form a happy circle, in which love rules and mutual confidence exists, is not known to heathenism. It cannot be. The religion of the Bible is the only one which asserts the true relation of the wife to her husband, and provides for the government and training of the family in accordance with that relation. And it is where the gospel exercises its most powerful influence that the home is most distinguished by those qualities of order, sympathy, affection, and comfort which we attach to its idea. In countries under the sway of popery, home life, in the highest sense of the word, scarcely exists. The subtle and pernicious influence of the priest comes between husband and wife, between parents and children, and destroys the confidence and freedom of their association. The great want of domesticity and the great amount of vice which prevail in popish countries are but too well known. Out of this divine order, faithfully fulfilled, what blessings may we not expect to flow? What holy, happy homes would thus bless our land and spread abroad, as from so many centres of power and influence for good on all our social life? From these, men and women would go forth to establish new homes in our own or in other lands, to spread abroad the influence by which they themselves had been blessed. Our Senate, our colleges, our halls of science, literature, and art would be thus replenished, not only with genius, but with genius sanctified by piety. The grand prayer of the psalmist would be answered, God be merciful unto us, and bless us, and cause his face to shine upon us, that thy ways may be known upon earth, thy saving health among all nations. Footnote, Psalm 67, verses 1 and 2, end footnote. Take the contrary view. Suppose that those ties which ought to be indissoluble were liable to disruption at the bidding of caprice or passion, and that the conjugal, the parental, and the filial relationships were continually set at naught. What shipwreck must ensue of honour, principle, and fair renown? Even as it has been with the nations of antiquity, so would it be again. Social corruption would prepare the way for national destruction. The more carefully we consider the law of the family as ordained by God, and view it in relation to the higher necessities of man's spiritual nature, the more fully we must be convinced that he, who knew what was in man, contemplated in this gracious ordinance our highest good, as well as our greatest earthly happiness. And when the family relationship is sanctified by piety, when husband and wife are one in the possession of a saving faith and of spiritual hopes, when the children are regarded as a heritage of the Lord, and therefore as a sacred trust, of which he will require an account, when the whole home life is regarded as his, there is a guarantee for happiness purer and more enduring than any that can exist on this side heaven. The Christian hope gives it its crowning glory, and makes it the purest earthly type of that state of blessedness which the believer can call by no name more endearing than his eternal home. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Christian Home Life by S.S. Pugh. The Bible and Home Life. If the statements of the previous chapter be accepted, we shall be prepared at once to make our appeal to the Word of God. In it, the law of the family is written for us both in precept and example. The family rests upon marriage, as marriage is understood according to the divine ordinance. The statement of the book of Genesis is decisive upon this point. And the Lord God said, It is not good that the man should be alone, I will make him an helpmeet for him. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Footnote, Genesis 2, verses 18 and 24, end footnote. This law was ordained for the human race at the very outset of man's life, before the entrance of sin into the world, and it was thus invested with a high moral significance. It contemplated not only earthly but spiritual blessings. As expounded by prophets, apostles, and by our Lord himself, it is a type of the divine relationship subsisting between God and the Church. Footnote, Isaiah 61, verse 10, Ephesians 5, verses 23 to 27, Revelation 19, verse 7, end footnote. Our Lord came not to destroy the law and the prophets, but to fulfil, and in his teaching, the law of marriage, which had been greatly violated by the Jews, was restored to its original purity. The Pharisees, tempting him, asked him to pronounce upon the lawfulness of divorce. His answer is contained in the words of the original law. the law of paradise was restored by the second Adam, the Lord from heaven, and remains the fundamental law of the family relationship in the new order of things introduced by his redemption. Footnote: see Matthew 19, verses 3 to 9, and 5, verse 32, end footnote. Lawless marriages were among the earliest fruits of man's sinful fall and materially helped to bring about the corrupt state of society which existed before the flood. But in the midst of the increasing wickedness, one family maintained its purity, and that purity God himself signally approved. Not for Noah's sake alone, but because his family had stood aloof from the seething vice amidst which they had lived, did God say to him, "Come thou and all thy house into the ark." There was one sad exception even here as to personal character, but the purity of the family relationship had been preserved. In this respect, they had isolated themselves from the world's corruption, and now they were alone with God in the awful solitude of a world destroyed. The one righteous family was saved. The divine law provides for the faithful discharge of family duties. The duties of husbands and wives, of parents and children, are clearly stated and enforced by the highest considerations. The religion of the Bible blends most fully with family life, and family life, as taught by that book, is the purest form of social life possible to man in his fallen state. It is poetic truth rather than poetic license which says, "Domestic happiness, thou only bliss of paradise which has survived the fall." The influence of the gospel on the position of woman in the family is so well known as to need only a passing allusion. Quote, "Wherever," says Neander, speaking of the early progress of the gospel, "Christianity found entrance, the equal dignity and worth of the female sex as possessing a nature created in the image of God, and allied to the divine no less than the man's, was brought distinctly before the mind." End quote. One of the early Christian fathers combating those ascetic tendencies which, no less than heathen licentiousness, are opposed to the pure spirit of the Christian life, writes, quote, "It is not in the solitary life one shows himself a man, but he excels other men who, as a husband and father of a family, withstands all the temptations that assail him in providing for his wife and children, without allowing himself to be turned from the love of God." End quote. And the same writer, describing the Christian matron, says, quote, "The mother is the glory of her children, the wife of her husband, both are the glory of the wife, and God is the glory of them all." End quote. And Tertullian writes of marriage between believers, quote, "What a union is that between two believers, having in common one hope, one desire, one order of life, one service of the Lord. Both, like brother and sister, undivided in spirit or body, nay, in the true sense, twain in one flesh, kneel, pray, and fast together, mutually teach, exhort, and bear with each other. They share in each other's troubles, persecutions, joys. Neither has anything to hide from the other. The harmony of psalms and hymns goes up between them. Christ rejoices to behold and hear such things, and sends them his peace." End quote. Indirectly, by incidental allusions as well as by direct statements, the Word of God gives its sanction to the family bond. The most endearing relationship which can subsist between man and his Maker is set before us by figures drawn from the parental and filial union. Footnote, 2 Corinthians 6, verse 18, end footnote. The kindness of earthly parents is employed to set forth his compassion towards those that fear him. Footnote, Psalm 103, verse 13, end footnote. The tenderness of a mother's love illustrates his tender care and affection to the sorrowing. Footnote, Isaiah 66, verse 13, end footnote. The union between Christ and the Church is symbolized by the marriage tie. Footnote, Ephesians 5, verses 23 to 32, end footnote. The affection and obedience of the child and the willingness of the parent to listen to his requests represent the feeling of the believer towards his heavenly Father and the gracious willingness of the Father to answer his prayers. Footnote, Matthew 7, verses 7 to 11, end footnote. Purity in the family relationship and wise discipline in the household were tests of a man's fitness to rule in the Church of God. Footnote, 1 Timothy 3, verses 5, 11, and 12, end footnote. The laws of the family life stand in most intimate and beautiful association with the hopes of the gospel. The spirit of Christ towards little children, pervades the whole record and teaches its writers an unspeakable tenderness in dealing with this subject. Parental obligation is very frequently taught in the Bible. The familiar intercourse of home was to be made subservient to religious instruction. Parents were to talk of these words with their children when they sat in the house, and when they walked by the way, and when they lay down, and when they rose up. Footnote: Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 and 7, chapter 11, verse 19, in footnote. The law of God was thus pointed out as the supreme law of the house. His truth was to be familiar in their mouths as household words. What better mode of instruction could be devised? And how could the divine lawgiver more clearly indicate the value which he attached to family piety? The denunciations of the word of God against violation of the family law and against corruption in the family bear the same witness. "Seest thou not what they do," exclaimed the prophet, "in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem? The children gather wood, and the fathers kindle the fire, and the women knead their dough to make cakes to the Queen of Heaven, and to pour out drink offerings unto other gods, that they may provoke me to anger." Footnote: Jeremiah 7, verses 17 and 18, end footnote. No wonder that the nation was corrupt when the very children were trained in the practice of idolatry. The prophecy of Micah is a fearful exposure of the evil state of the nation through the corruption of its domestic life. The prevailing treachery, cruelty, deceit, oppression, and injustice are denounced in unsparing terms, but the words which give us the deepest insight into the state of the nation are found in the last chapter. "Trust ye not in a friend, put ye not confidence in a guide. Keep the doors of thy mouth from her that lieth in thy bosom. For the son dishonoureth the father, the daughter riseth up against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are the men of her own house." Here was the root of the evil. The family was corrupt. The sacred ties of domestic life were continually being violated. The disease was in the very heart of the people. The concluding words of the last of the Jewish prophets are very significant in this view. He points out the difficulties against which the herald of the Messiah would have to contend, and announces the penalty which awaited those who would not receive his warning. Those difficulties would be found, he shows, in the moral degeneracy of the nation, and of that degeneracy the violation of the family law was the great proof. He was to come to turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest, says Jehovah, I come and smite the earth with a curse. Footnote: Malachi 4, verse 6, and footnote. The words of our Lord, Matthew 15, verses 3-8, remarkably show that in his time the law of the family was perpetually and even systematically dishonoured. The hearts of the fathers had not been turned to the children, nor the hearts of the children to their fathers, and the fearful end of the nation 40 years later was the fulfilment of the divine threatening. We have abundant proof in Scripture that God has given to the family a very important place in the scheme of his moral government. The history of the Jewish nation fully shows this, and many passages from the Old Testament might be quoted in illustration. But the general tenor of the law of Moses, and the importance which is everywhere attached to the purity of the family, prove it even more strongly than single texts. The retribution wrought upon the Egyptians, so accurately corresponding to their cruel attempt to destroy the families of the Israelites. Footnote: Exodus 12, verses 29 and 30, end footnote. The institution of the feast of the Passover as a family ordinance. Footnote: Exodus 12, verses 3, 4, 21 and 27, end footnote. The dedication of the firstborn as a token of the consecration of the family to God. Footnote: Exodus 13, verse 2. The recognition of family ties as of prime importance in the distribution of property. Footnote: Numbers 27, verses 6-11, 36, verses 1-12, end footnote. The blessings promised to families and the judgments denounced against them as such. Footnote: Deuteronomy 1, verse 36, Leviticus 20, verse 5, Numbers 16, verses 26-33, 1 Kings 21, verse 22, Jeremiah 23, verse 34, 31, verse 1, chapter 35, end footnote. May be cited as proofs of the importance attached to the family by the divine law. Circumstances have changed, but the truth remains. The principles of the divine government are the same in all ages. The word which cannot pass away teaches us in what light we ought now to regard the family institution. It is still God's ordinance, it still occupies an important place in the scheme of his moral government. The first commandment with promise is unrepealed. Parental obligation, as taught by the law of Moses, devolves upon us now. The relation of a virtuous, well-trained family to the well-being of succeeding generations cannot be destroyed. Its blessings not only widen but descend. Instead of the fathers are the children. The remembrance of a pious ancestry is more valuable than untold wealth, is an honour higher than all earthly distinctions. My boast is not that I deduce my birth from loins enthroned and rulers of the earth, but higher far my proud pretensions rise, the son of parents passed into the skies. Cooper. The relation of the family to the establishment and spread of the divine kingdom in the world is another aspect of this truth. Quote, "What," says John Howe, "will God have these families for?" Plainly, to be seminaries of religion. He did not design the original constitution of that fundamental relation by which mankind was to be continued and propagated in this world, only that there might be a continued descent of human nature, but that religion might still be transmitted from age to age, and this design of his he never quits. End quote. This view is strikingly confirmed by the fact that the covenant with Abraham is made to rest on the ground of his family piety. Footnote Genesis 18, verse 19. End footnote. And it was promised to him that in his seed all the families of the earth should be blessed. God tells us by the prophet that he did not make the earth in vain, that he formed it to be inhabited. Footnote Isaiah 45, verse 18. End footnote. But with what kind of inhabitants would he have it peopled? Will not his design be fulfilled when the promise to Abraham shall be accomplished in Christ, when the waste and desolate places shall be dwelt in by the families of those that serve him? By them shall earth's wildernesses be like Eden, and her deserts like the garden of the Lord. Footnote Isaiah 51 verse 3, end footnote. Dr. Krapf, well known by his missionary labours and researches in Eastern Africa, thus bears testimony to the value of the family in relation to missionary efforts. Quote, "These tribes," he says, "at once sensual and destitute of all the conveniences of life, should have Christianity presented to them not only in sermons and teaching, but realized and embodied, exercising its influence on everyday life, especially in the married state and in the bringing up of children. Families, Christian families, really converted fathers and mothers with well-nurtured children, are the tools which are chiefly needed for missionary work in Eastern Africa. Once surround the missionary with families who present in living, visible reality, Christianity in life and death, in labour and repose, in marriage and education, in public worship, in common prayer and psalmody, in devout listening to the word of God, then will our poor, careless Wanika easily and clearly understand to what a blessed condition out of their prison destitution, to what life out of death, to what light out of darkness, to what joy in the Holy Spirit out of present dread of evil spirits, to what love out of selfishness, to what genuine peace out of worldly security, we are helping them." End quote. Both in the Old and New Testaments, peculiar honour is put upon the family relationship. Families are everywhere spoken of as a blessing. And the idea is not merely an Eastern one, belonging to a certain stage of social progress and to a country but scantily populated. It rather teaches us what the conditions of our social life ought always to be. There is something fundamentally wrong in a state of society where children are a burden. They are an heritage of the Lord. Footnote Psalm 127 verse 3. End footnote. The richness of the olive expresses the wealth which a man possesses in them. The blessing of the man that feareth the Lord is, "Yea, thou shalt see thy children's children, and peace upon Israel." Footnote Psalm 128 verse 6. End footnote. Children's children, Solomon tells us, are the crown of old men. Footnote Proverbs 17 verse 6. End footnote. The truth thus taught of old in the Word of God has been recognized by all civilized nations in the best and purest period of their national existence. Increase of population is admitted to be one of the evidences of national prosperity, and thus an experienced and humane philosophy does homage, as it always must, to the supreme authority of the Word of God. The family is the backbone of the nation. Footnote Psalm 127 verses 4 and 5. End footnote. The history of the holy child Jesus is one which, more than any other, shows the honour which is put upon the family relationship. our blessed Lord, in condescending to take upon himself our nature, became a member of a family. It was in the household of the just Joseph, and under the care of the devout and pious Mary, that he spent his childhood and youth. He submitted to the family law. He grew up under the influence of family affections and family sympathies. He, who in his helpless infancy was cradled in a mother's arms, learnt from a mother's lips the histories and prophecies of holy men of old, which had prepared for his coming. The numerous examples of family piety, mentioned with such honour in the Bible, teach the same lesson. Abraham, the father of the faithful, has been already referred to. Later in the history, and just at the important crisis of the settlement of the people in the Promised Land, the conduct of Joshua stands out very clearly in relation to family religion. In the last act of his career, the servant of God comes prominently forward, not only in his public but in his domestic life. We can imagine how, amid the duties which pressed upon him as the leader of the people and commander of their armies, he found rest and refreshment to his spirit in the retirement of a home sanctified by religion. And now that the time of his departure is at hand, he gathers all Israel together to give them his final counsels. With military conciseness he recounts the merciful dealings of God with the people and asserts his claims. But the force of his appeal was supplied by his own resolve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The pious care of the patriarch Job over his sons and his allusions to domestic life show us how fully he recognized the great importance of family piety. Looking back upon the brighter past, he mentions two things which imply this. Oh, that I were in my months past, when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle, when my children were about me. Footnote, Job 29, verses 2 to 5. His care for them in after life indicates that they had been trained in the ways of the Lord. It is a beautiful picture of the early and comparatively pure days of Oriental life, which is given in the first chapter of the book of Job. The sons, now grown up and settled in life, maintain a constant intercourse between each other, with their sisters and with their old home. The father watches with delight their prosperity and their affection, and with holy solicitude seeks to use his influence and authority as the head of the house to guide them in the ways of holiness. The priest, as well as the patriarch, he calls them to the solemn duties of religious worship, and offers sacrifices on their behalf. Thus did Job continually. Footnote, Job 1, verse 5. There are few of the patriarchs, judges, and pious kings of Israel whose history does not contain some testimony to the importance of family piety. The testimony, indeed, is woven into the very texture of the history. The case of the parents of Moses is decisive as to family religion, even during the degradation and misery of Egyptian slavery. Footnote, compare the narrative, Exodus 2, verses 1 to 10, with Hebrews 11, verse 23. The parents of Samson sought the Lord with earnest desire on behalf of their son. Footnote, Judges chapter 13, verses 8, 22 and 23, end footnote. The narrative of the birth and dedication of the prophet Samuel cannot fail to bring before us the simple but exalted faith of his mother. Footnote, 1 Samuel 1, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11, end footnote. The history of Ruth, so charming in its pure poetry, is no less beautiful as an example of filial piety.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.